Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Free Will, written by Mark Balaguer, read by Stephen Menasche. Chapter 1, Introduction. In the last few years, several people have argued that science has shown us that human beings don't have free will. People like Daniel Wegner, a Harvard psychologist, and Sam Harris, a neuroscientist and the author of various popular philosophy books, claim that certain scientific findings reveal that free will is an illusion. If this were true, it would be less than splendid. And it would be surprising, too, because it really seems like we have free will. It seems that what we do from moment to moment is determined by conscious decisions that we freely make. Suppose, for instance, that I'm lying on my couch watching TV, and I suddenly decide to get up and go for a walk. It seems that the reason that I got up and went for a walk is that I made a conscious decision to do so. I could have kept watching TV, or I could have done something completely different. Hell, I could have painted myself green and pretended I was the Incredible Hulk, engaged in a battle to the death with an evil troupe of Lithuanian trapeze artists. But I didn't. I went for a walk. And when I did that, I exercised my free will. Or so it seems to us. But if people like Wegner and Harris are right, then this feeling of freedom that we all have is an illusion. On their view, we don't really have free will. In other words, we don't have any real choice about what we do. Rather, on their view, everything we do is completely caused by things that are totally out of our control. And again, according to these people, there is scientific evidence that supports the claim that we don't have free will. I don't trust these people. It's not that I don't trust science. On the contrary, I really trust science. I think it's the best way we have of acquiring knowledge about the world. I just don't trust people. And I really don't trust people who tell me that science has shown that some crazy claim is true. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm fully aware that science has already shown us that lots of crazy claims are true. But for every case where science has legitimately established the truth of some crazy-sounding result, there are 1,000 cases where people erroneously claim that science has established a crazy-sounding result. So the moral here is this. Just because someone with a PhD in a lab coat tells you that science has established some nutty conclusion doesn't mean it's really true. Of course, it doesn't mean it's false either. My claim is simply that we have to check it out for ourselves. So I'm completely open to the idea that science could establish that we don't have free will. After all, our decision-making processes are brain processes. In particular, they're neural processes, and neural processes are obviously in the domain of scientific investigation. That's just what neuroscience does. It studies neural processes. So it's a real possibility that neuroscientists could discover that we don't have free will. I'm just not sure that they have discovered this. So I want to look for myself and see if they're right. That's what this book is going to be about. I'm going to discuss and evaluate the various arguments and scientific experiments that people have put forward in support of the claim that human beings don't have free will. By the end of the book, we'll be able to answer the question of whether the various arguments are any good. In other words, we'll be able to say whether we really do have good reason to give up our belief in free will. Before going any further, I want to bring out an issue that will be relevant to our discussion. Broadly speaking, we can endorse 2 different views about the nature of human beings. These 2 views can be summarized as follows. First, the spiritual, religious view of humans. Every person has an immortal soul, or a non-physical spirit, that's distinct from the physical body, and that somehow drives the body or tells the body what to do. For instance, if you're thirsty and you consciously decide to go into the kitchen to get a glass of water, then it's your soul that makes this conscious decision and causes your body to get up and start walking. And the second view, the materialistic scientific view of humans. There is no more to human being than his or her physical body. There is no non-physical soul in addition to the body. So everything about you that makes you who you are can be found in your brain. Your beliefs and desires, your hopes and fears, your memories, your feelings of love and hate. These are all in your brain, coded by neural pathways. And if we want to know why you got up and walked into the kitchen, we just have to look at your brain. There's nowhere else to look, because you don't have a non-physical soul. Your thirstiness was a physical thing, neurally coded in your brain. Moreover, your conscious decision to go get some water was also physical. It was a physical, neural event that occurred in your brain. And this neural event caused your muscles to move, and so on and so forth. The debate between these two views is obviously very heated and controversial in its own right, and I am not going to try to settle this debate here. But the difference between these two views of human beings is important to our topic for a few reasons. The first point to note is that the scientific enemies of free will, people like Wegner and Harris, who think that science has shown that we don't have free will, generally assume something like a materialistic, scientific view of humans. Now, given this, you might think, so if I believe in God, and if I believe that I have a non-physical soul, then I don't have to worry about the arguments that these people have given. I don't have to worry that I might not have free will. But it's not obvious that this is right. It may be that the belief in souls doesn't solve the problem. In other words, it may be that even if you accept the spiritual religious view, even if you believe that we all possess non-physical souls that drive our bodies, you can't use this belief to weasel out the arguments against free will. It may be that the arguments against free will still go through. We'll have to see about this. In any event, whatever we say about whether the spiritual religious view can be used to block the arguments against free will, I'm going to spend much more time looking for a response to the anti-free will arguments that we can all use, regardless of whether we believe in non-physical souls. In doing this, I will often be assuming, for the sake of argument, that the materialistic, scientific view of humans is correct. In other words, the question I'll be trying to answer is whether we can find a way of responding to the arguments against free will if we assume that human beings don't have non-physical souls. My idea here is that if we can find a way for materialists to respond to the anti-free will arguments, then advocates of the spiritual religious view should be able to respond in a similar way. So, by proceeding in this fashion, we'll actually be looking for a response that everyone can use. But in the spirit of disclosure, so you know who you're listening to here, let me lay my cards on the table. I don't believe in God, and I don't believe in non-physical souls. I'm not a mad dog, foaming at the mouth atheist, but I just, in fact, don't believe that there are any such things as gods or non-physical souls. But this view of mine won't really matter in this book because, again, I'm going to be looking for an answer to the arguments against free will that we can all use. And what's more, I'm going to address the question of whether we can escape the anti-free will arguments by abandoning materialism and endorsing the idea that we all have non-physical souls. Before getting down to business, I should probably say something about the fact that free will is important to us. This is a point that is often made by people writing on this topic. They tell us that free will is central to morality, religion, politics, and our legal system. Indeed, we're told that free will is crucial to our concept of ourselves as human beings. This is perhaps all true, but I smell a rat. This sounds to me like an attempt to justify the decision to write about free will. Moreover, I think that these highbrow, noble-sounding musings fail to get the main reason that we care about the question of whether we have free will. The main reason we care about this question is that we want free will. We want it for the same reason that we want ice cream and happiness and sex. Because it's good. Free will is just an intrinsically good thing that we all want. So, if it turned out that we don't have it, that the feeling of free will is an illusion, that would just be bad. But of course, if free will is intrinsically desirable, it might also be true that it's important as a means to other things. For instance, you might think that we need free will in order to justify the way that we treat criminals. You might think that if people don't have free will, then no one deserves to be punished. Consider, for instance, Bruno Hauptmann, who was convicted of kidnapping and murdering Charles Lindbergh's baby. Most people would say that if Hauptmann was in fact guilty, then he deserved to be punished for his crimes. But if he didn't have any free will, if his actions were caused by things that were completely out of his control, so that he didn't have any genuine choice about what he did, then it's hard to see how his actions were his fault, and it's hard to see how it could be fair to blame him. We might still incarcerate criminals like this just to protect ourselves, but if they don't have free will, then it's hard to see how they deserve this treatment. The moral thinking behind this argument might be right, but I have a hard time believing that there is anything of real pragmatic use here. Even if we become utterly convinced that people don't have free will, nothing much would change. It would be big news for a few days, but then we'd get bored and move on to the next big thing. Like Lindsay Lohan getting a DUI or whatever. And if after the discovery that humans don't have free will, someone kidnapped and murdered your baby, I'm betting dollars to donuts that you'd feel moral outrage. You'd feel in your heart that the murderer deserved to be punished, free will or no free will. People are people. And if we really discover that we don't have free will, I don't think it would change much of anything. But this doesn't mean that it wouldn't be big news. It would. And it would be bad news. It would be like learning that there was no more chocolate. It wouldn't be the end of the world if we found out that we would have to make do without chocolate, and within a few days we'd move on, we'd start eating more vanilla and caramel, and that would be the end of it. But this doesn't change the fact that we like chocolate, and we don't want to live without it. And the same goes for free will. An anonymous referee for this book objected here on the grounds that some people don't like chocolate. If this were true, it would of course be devastating to my argument, but I don't believe it for a second. Most people who claim not to like chocolate are dirty liars who can usually be discovered sneaking Snickers bars behind the dumpster in the parking lot. And the remaining few who honestly believe they don't like chocolate are simply confused. They usually just haven't tried chocolate in the right setting. If you're in this category, try eating an entire Sara Lee chocolate cake while lying in bed, under the covers, with the curtains drawn, watching reruns of As the World Turns. I think you'll be surprised at the results. Chapter 2. The Case Against Free Will. I want to start by presenting the arguments against free will. Later, I'll try to figure out whether these arguments are any good. But in this chapter, I just want to formulate the arguments in the strongest way I can as the enemies of free will conceive of them. The central idea behind the arguments against free will is the idea of determinism, so I'll begin there. Determinism. Let's start off by thinking about pool balls. Suppose you hit a cue ball into an 8-ball, and the 8-ball goes into a corner pocket. Given the way that the cue ball hit the 8-ball, given the exact force of the impact and the exact way that the cue ball was spinning and so on, it seems that there was only one thing that the 8-ball could have done. In other words, it seems that the way the cue ball hit the 8-ball determined the path that the 8-ball would follow. It seems that the 8-ball couldn't have done anything else. You can think of this in terms of the laws of physics. It seems that the eight ball was forced to behave in the way that it did by the laws of physics or the laws of nature. Determinism is the view that all events are like this. It's the view that every physical event is completely caused by prior events together with the laws of nature. Or, to put the point differently, it's the view that every event has a cause that makes it happen in the one and only way that it could have happened. Actually, this characterization of determinism is a bit rough. If you want a precise definition, we can say that determinism is the view that a complete statement of the laws of nature, together with a complete description of the universe at some specific time, logically entails a complete description of the universe at all later times. But however we define determinism, the main point I want to make here is that intuitively it seems right. Indeed, it can seem downright obvious. To see why, consider a different case involving pool balls. Suppose that we set up two balls right next to each other and that you and I hit them simultaneously, very lightly, with our pool cues. And suppose that my ball rolls 12 inches before stopping, whereas your ball rolls 12.1 inches. Given this, let's ask the following question. Why did your ball go further than mine did? Well, the obvious answer is that you hit your ball a bit harder than I did. But of course, there are other possible explanations we might give. It could be that we hit the balls with equal force, but that your ball weighs a bit less than mine. Or it could be that there was a bit more friction on the part of the table that my ball rolled over. Or whatever. We might not know the answer to the above question, but it seems clear that there has to be an answer. But imagine someone responding to our question by saying this. There's no reason why your ball went farther. It just did. The two balls have the exact same mass, and they were hit with the exact same force, and there were exactly equivalent amounts of friction on the two parts of the table, and so on. In short, there were no differences between the two cases. The one ball just went farther than the other one did, and that's all there is to it. In other words, nothing caused this to happen. It just did. Intuitively, this seems crazy. It would seem very natural to respond to this little speech by saying something like the following. What in the Sam Hill are you talking about? Physical
events. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.